has not been an easy reading or service this morning. I suppose you think that when a pastor or a guest speaker has a sermon and speaks to you, that it was not too bad for them to put something together and talk to you. But I've always followed with my sermons the Holy Gospel reading, and occasionally the readings that the readers give. Today was a real difficult thing because John's Gospel starts with the Word of God and the light of men. And of course, Jesus had said, "I am the light of the world." And this is the way John's Gospel starts, the Word of God, the light of men. Jesus had said, "I am the light of the world." Light stands for God's realm of truth, righteousness, purity, joy, ineffable glory. Darkness stands for the word of error, evil, ignorance, wickedness, and abode of the lost. In a more real and literal sense, light may be an attribute of God's beyond the understanding of fleshly eyes. God clothes himself beyond the understanding of fleshly eyes as he clothes himself with light. God dwells in light, unapproachable. He was the Father of lights, was one of his names that James gave him. Jesus' garments at his transfiguration became glistening white. The angel at Jesus' resurrection was white as snow. The two who accompanied Jesus in his ascension were in white. In the vision in Revelation, Jesus' head and hair were white as snow. And if you'll recall in the Old Testament, when Moses went to Mount Sinai and spoke with God, God was bright as white, a bright light that he could hardly see beyond the brightness. And this has to be something important to God, to put things in perspective of being white. We also know a few things about sin. What is it? Love thy neighbor as thyself, malice of forethought, Ten Commandments, thou shalt not sin. I've always said that's a commandment. If you were writing a book on sin, let me write three chapters for you, okay? I got good experience. But I'll return to that in a little bit. In the reading today, there was a reference to God, that he was the light, and in him there is no darkness. If we walk in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus purifies us from all sin. The word sin in 1 John occurs 27 times. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world." Light stands for God's realm of truth, righteousness, purity, joy, ineffable glory. And darkness stands for the world of error, evil, ignorance, wickedness, and abode of the lost, which I've already said. In a more real and literal sense, light may be an attribute of God beyond the understanding of us. Our pastor said in his sermon last week that our church was in turmoil. I don't know how many of you recall that. I didn't quite understand him, but since then, Carrie fill me in. As I told the children when I was a boy, my dad said many times to me, if you can't say something nice about someone, then say nothing at all. Turmoil. After church last week, I saw Carrie, our church wizard with children, crying. I went to her and she told me that someone went to the church council and questioned that since Carrie and her partner, Tim, were planning to reside together, then why should she be retained as a youth director? What confused me is that the person never talked to Carrie first. He was proven guilty until she could prove her innocence. Back in time, in the 1940s, and I'm sure all of you will remember the 1940s, if a man and woman decided to live together unmarried, that was absolutely horrible. Horrible. In fact, in some communities, they shunned people. They wouldn't talk to them. That's disgusting what you're doing. Interesting. In the 60s and 70s, not only did couples live together unmarried, but they lived in communes with lots of other couples. I'm sure many of you remember that, right? Right? Now in the year 2000 and on, it is commonplace for couples to live together unmarried. I'm not saying doing that is fine or not doing that is fine. I'm just saying this is what's happened in our culture. The changes have been made. But I can tell you from personal experience, I lived with Rita 2 months before we were married. Of course, there was no backlash for us. Most of the people, we just didn't talk about it, and no one asked us about it, so that's the way it was left. But my youngest daughter agreed to live with her good friend in Palmer, Alaska. When she did that, there was no backlash, none whatsoever. And I must say, her story is very interesting. She had met him at the American Legion, where he was actively involved, and he became ill, and he became very ill. And because she liked him, she asked him if she could come and, during her free time, take care of him. And he said yes. And then he said, well, as long as you're taking care of me and you have to drive here every day, why don't you just stay in one of my extra bedrooms? And she said, okay. And that's what she did. And many of the people at the American Legion told me when I came up there for their wedding that if she had not been there to take care of him, they know that he would have died. So, it's really hard for me to make a comment to her or anyone else for that matter about whether they're doing something right or wrong, because there are probably reasons why they're doing what they're doing and they're justifiable. Anyway, I thought, what effect could Carrie's personal life have on our youth? I believe nothing. This is a different culture. And us older folks have got to suck it up and accept it. By the way, there's a school near here where over 50% of the youth live in single-parent family homes. Interesting, huh? And there's one school that I know of that 70% of the children have free lunch. 70%. So I give you all this information and I say, who is sinning now? The target or the accuser? I'm not going to be hard on the accuser, because I think in their heart they thought they were doing the right thing. And therefore, I feel they should be forgiven. But they need to think first before opening their mouth. And they should have thought about what effect would that have on Carrie and Tim, besides what effect would it have on the children. And by the way, for your information, Carrie has left her job with our church. Last Thursday was her last day. And she's accepted a job with another company, which, by the way, offers her fantastic benefits, better than what we offer. And she, by the way, upon receiving the offer from the company, she received a $10,000 a year raise. And I think that was also from part-time and full-time. But I still think that's just a wonderful, wonderful thing to have happen to end a very sad experience for her, she and Tim. If you did not follow my father's rule, but said something bad about a person, hurting their reputation and their dignity or self-respect, would you call that action a sin? I think it is. Why should we, any of us, be hurtful toward a person? Let's walk in the light with God.